بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Today we'll talk about ECG interpretation. We will go mainly for basic dysrhythmia interpretations. We will not go to talk about 12-lead ECG any in details, but we will just touch on the changes in the ST segment as part of the interpretation of the ECG. The lecture is a bit long, and it might be a little bit fast presentation because we have restricted time, which is around 1 hour. I hope that we can finish everything on time. The aim or the main objectives of the presentation is to understand the conduction system, or its functions, and the characteristics of each ECG rhythm that we see, and where is the origin of that ECG rhythm. Mainly, our conduction system of the heart is the SA node, which is located in the upper third of the right atrium. And whenever we have a central line or a PICC line that inserted at the right side of the heart of the patient body, we have to make sure that the central line is not deep enough because it might stimulate the SA node and cause tachycardias. The main function of the SA node is the natural pacemaker, and it control a rate for the heart, which we call the action potential of the SA node, between 60 to 100. Usually, any rate below 60, we call it Brady. Any rate above 100, we call it tachycardia. And the secondary pacemaker is the AV node, which is it has three major functions. The major function is the second pacemaker. If the SA node is not functioning for any reason, then the rhythm or the pacemaker will escape from SA node from sinus to junctional. The second function of the AV node is to filter excessive atrial conductions. So if the patient has atrial fibrillation or he has atrial tachycardia or atrial flutter, then the AV node will block most of the excessive atrial conductions in order to maintain a normal ventricular rate. Normal ventricular rate is important to maintain a normal cardiac output, because the patient heart rate goes very fast, then the filling of the left ventricle will go down, and then the amount of the blood that will be ejected from the left ventricle will go down. It's like a part of the diastolic dysfunction related to tachycardia. And the third function of the AV node, it causes a bit, what we call it, a slow delay in the atrial conduction before it reaches the ventricles, in order to allow for both atria to depolarize, in order to get the atrial kick. Purkinje's fibers, which is the last conduction system down here, okay, they are the tertiary or the third level pacemaker. If SA node is not working, AV node is not working, then it takes the third level. Usually, the AV node can provide you a rate between 40 to 60, and the Purkinje's fibers, which is the third level pacemaker, will give you a rate between 20 to 40. The ECG itself is a voltmeter, so when you place your electrodes, you are recording the electrical activity that is going on within the heart itself. And the ECG does not tell you anything about the mechanical function of the heart, because you might see a patient who have an ECG rhythm, but the patient is pulseless. So always, when you have an arrhythmia or any kind of abnormal rhythm, you have to go and assess your patient cardiovascular function by checking pulse and looking for signs of life. The lead itself is a very important device, because whenever you place your lead, it will pick up the electricity. That's why the placement of the lead is something that we all have to pay attention to. The standard limp leads, which is the right arm, the left arm, and the left foot, when you place it on the patient's chest, it has to give you lead 2 upright, which means it's a positive lead. P1 is up, R is up, and the T wave is up. Any technician who perform an ECG has to pay attention to this. Any doctor who is reading the ECG, before you read the ECG, you have to look at lead 2. If lead 2 is inverted down, it means somebody has placed the right arm on the left arm, and vice versa. So the axis has been switched between right side to left side. The ECG paper, when you print a strip from the ECG, your ECG paper upright direction is a voltmeter. It will tell you about the electrical activity that is going on within your patient heart by looking at every different wave, because each different wave is an accumulation of electrical volt or an electrical voltage value. the paper is divided into large boxes, and the time of the large box from the beginning of the box to the end of the box is 0.20 seconds. And that large box has been divided into small boxes, and each small box time is 0.4 second. So whenever you calculate an interval between a wave and a next wave, you measure number of the small boxes and you multiply it by the time of the small box, which is equal to 0.04. So if I have three small boxes between in the interval, then the time of the interval is 0.12. So this is why we use the paper with the smaller and large boxes in order to measure the intervals. And in the beginning, we can also use it to calculate the heart rate. So the terminology, when you look at the ECG wave, the wave is the movement away from the baseline, which is the straight line on the base of the ECG, which shows that there is no electrical activity or the electric volt is zero. When the wave moves up or down, okay, this is a wave. So if the wave goes up and then moves down and then gets back to the baseline, this is what we consider it a wave. That's why the P wave, the first wave, is moving up and getting back. And then the Q, we will describe it in the next slides. Segment is the line between two waves. And the interval is from the beginning of the wave to the beginning of the next wave, which includes the wave and the segment after it. And the complex is the complete several waves together, which is the PQRST. And if there is additional waves on the ECG, this is what we call it, a complex. The first wave will appear on our ECG complex is the P wave. And the P wave naturally represents the depolarization or the contraction of the atria. The sinus P wave comes from the SA node. That's why the characteristics of that wave is it's a smooth and rounded normally. And usually it is a small because it does not exceed 2.5 small boxes. It is positive mainly in lead 2, and the advice is always to take a strip of lead 2. And it might be positive, negative, if you are taking a wave that is negative. If you look at different size shapes of P waves, or we call it the P wave configuration or morphology, this is a normal P wave. And if you look at the second wave, you have a P wave that has a notch, or it's a headed P wave. They usually call it P and delta P. You see this phenomena in patients with Wolff-Parkinson-White syndrome when the patient has a secondary accessory pathway between the SA node and the AV node in the atria. This is a peaked P wave, and this is the last one is an inverted P wave. Usually the inverted P waves, we see it in junctional arrhythmias because the conduction from the injunctional usually comes upward, which is against the direction of the electricity. We'll talk about it in the junctional. Now, the PR interval is one of the most important things that you need to pay attention to, because prolongation of PR interval longer than 0.20, which is normally should be between 0.12 to 0.20, and if you calculate it as number of small boxes, it is 3 to 5 small boxes. Any PR interval longer than 0.20 in a sinus rhythm, we call it a sinus rhythm with a first degree AV block. When you are assessing blocks, usually you identify what kind of a block you have by looking at the PR interval and what is the relationship between the P and the R. So the PR interval is something very important when we are interpreting heart blocks. The next complex of waves you will see is the QRS, and the QRS represents the depolarization of the ventricles, which is the contraction of the ventricles. Now, the measurements of the QRS is from the beginning of the Q to the end of the S. So as you look here, your P wave ends here from isoelectric back to isoelectric, then the Q is from isoelectric down. So this is the Q wave. Then you have the R, and then you have the S, has to get down and come back. Normally, the PR interval from here to here is 0.04 to 0.10, okay, seconds, which is like it's 1 to 2.5 small squares. But the QRS can go up to 0.12. Any QRS longer or wider than 0.12, we consider it a wide complex. The ST segment, as you see here, it's the line or the segment between the S and the T, and this segment always affected by the ischemia. If the patient has MI or myocardial infarct, then the ST segment might travel up, and we call it ST elevation, or might go down, and we call it ST depression. And in this case, the comparison of the ST segment will happen between the ST segment and the PR segment. Any patient comes with chest pain, and he has ST changes, like ST elevation or ST depression, you need to suspect that this patient might have myocardial infarct. So further investigations has to happen. And the ST segment itself is part of the ventricular depolarization. T wave that starts up after the ST segment, it represents the repolarization, which is the relaxation of both ventricles. And the atrial repolarization, which is the relaxation of the atria, is at the same time of the QRS. T wave normally should not exceed 20 to 25% of the length of the QRS. If you see an inverted T wave, usually we see inverted T waves in patients with acute ischemias. People who have peaked or tall P waves, usually those patients are suspected to have hyperkalemia. If patient has hypokalemia, usually the T wave goes short, but it goes up to be flattened. The QT is the interval between the Q to the end of the T, and it represents the total time of depolarization and repolarization of the ventricles. It is important to look at our patient QT, especially for those who are well known to have hypomagnesemia, or they are on medications that can lead to prolongation of the QT. People with prolongation of QT are always liable to develop what we call it polymorphic ventricular tachycardia, or Torsades D point. We will discuss it in the next slides. And the main problem with the QT, it change for the same patients if the heart rate change. So if the patient has a heart rate of 60, then he become 100, his QT will change. That's why we don't measure just the QT, we have to correct the QT to the heart rate. And in this case, we have to use the formula, which we call it the QTC, which is the QT corrected to the heart rate. You measure your QT in seconds. So if you look at this example, from the beginning of the Q to the end of the T, we have to calculate number of small boxes, which is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, let's say 15, for example, multiplied by 0.04. This will give you the time of the QT. Then you measure the time between R to R. You get the square root of R to R. Then you divide the QT over the square root of R to R. Also, there are on the smartphones, there is an application you can download it. It measures for you the QTC. And there are ready tables. You need always to measure the QT. Find the heart rate, and it will give you the QTC already in that table. The importance of the QTC is if the QTC is prolonging gradually, it means my patient has a problem. Just to get back to the rhythm or the complex, P wave represents atrial depolarization. The QRST represents ventricular depolarization, and atrial depolarization happen at the same time. And the T wave represents ventricular repolarization. ST segment is considered part of the ventricular depolarization as well. And for the intervals that we need to measure, from this is the P wave, from here to here, while the PR interval is from the beginning of the P to the end of the Q, to the beginning of the Q. Normal PR interval is 0.12 to 0.20 seconds. The normal QRS is from the beginning of the Q to the end of the S, and normally should be less than 0.12, but it can go as much as 0.12. Any QRS above 0.12 is considered a wide complex. Then you have the QT. You measure the QT. Normally it is under 38, but if your patient has variation in his QT, you have to measure his QTC. It's much more accurate. Now, in a 6-second strip, what do we mean by a 6-second strip? We have to fix in our patient file a 6-second strip. I go and print a strip. Then I have to have 30 large boxes strip. So from the beginning of the QRS here, the beginning of the P wave or the complex, to the end of the page, I have to have 30 large squares, okay? Now, to calculate the rate, you have one method that applies to all rhythms, either they are regular or irregular. You count number of QRSs, which is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Then you multiply it by 10. So 10 times 10 is 100. If you have only 6 complexes here, then your rate is 60. Why I multiply it by 10? Because the 30-second strip, okay, or the 6-second strip, which is the 30 complexes, is 10% of a full-minute rhythm. The next method is counting number of QRSs, number of complexes between two QRSs. Here we use the large boxes. If you have one large box between two QRSs, you divide it into 300. So 300 divided by number of boxes. If you have one box, your rate is 300. If you have two boxes, your rate is 150. If you have three boxes, your rate is 100. If you have four, your rate is 75. But if you don't have like a straight box, you have boxes that are small and large. Each small box is 0.2. So if I have three large boxes and one small box, then I divide 300 divided by 3.2. If they are small boxes, then it's 3.4 and so forth. The second method, okay, is using number of small boxes. It's the same concept. I take from R to R, count number of small boxes. If I find like from here to here 18 boxes, then my calculation is 1,500 divided by number of small boxes. So those are the three methods to calculate the heart rate using an ECG strip. Analyzing the ECG rhythm, number one, you have to calculate the ventricular rate, which is number of R to R. And then you have to calculate the atrial rate, which is the P waves. So QRS represents ventricular rate. P waves represents ventricular atrial rate. Then after that, you need to see if your patient is regular or irregular. And you do that by marking two QRSs, and then you move your caliber from one to one in order to find if there is an irregularity or not. After that, you assess your rate. Any patient has a rate less than 60 is bradycardia. Any rate greater than 100 is tachycardia. So 59 below is bradycardia, 101 and above is tachycardia. 100 is considered still normal. Then you have to look at your P waves in each different complex. So if you have like 6 or 10 complexes in your ECG strip, you have to look at every P wave because maybe one of them has a different morphology and that gives you an arrhythmia. Second, you have to measure your PR interval, and prolongation or differences in PR interval usually represents heart blocks. Then you measure your complexes from normal to wide, okay? And then after that, you measure your QT and your QTC. And then after that, you look at your patient clinical status. If your patient has tachycardia, you need to see if this patient has hemodynamic stability or not. Patient has bradycardia, is he hemodynamically stable or not? Okay, so this was the introduction. Now we will move to the rhythms, sinus rhythms. And the sinus rhythm, if I will apply my rules, the rate is 60, and I calculate it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. This is 70. Then my rate is between 60 to 100. It is regular. P waves are uniformed in all the complexes. And the PR interval is normal in all the complexes. And the QRS duration is normal. And this is exactly what we call it normal sinus rhythm. It's normal for the rate, and it is sinus for the
characteristics of the P wave, because the P wave will give the name for the rhythm. Now, if I still have a patient who has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, rate 50, and the rhythm is regular between R to R, and I have one P wave that is small, normal, positive before the QRS, this is a sinus bradycardia. And something else in this rhythm, if you look at it, you will notice that there is ST depression. So when you assess, you have to look at the rhythm, and also if there is any other problems in the rhythm, you have to look at it. This rhythm that you see on the screen, this patient has bradycardia, yes. This bradycardia is sinus because the P wave is sinus, but the patient as well is having an ST depression. Then you have to pay attention to this thing. Now, sinus bradycardia, you have to speed up the heart using atropine, using dopamine infusion or epinephrine infusion, or using the transcutaneous pacer. When the rate goes higher than 110, but still the rhythm has the same characteristics, which is a P wave that is normal before each QRS, and the PR interval is normal in all the complex, and the P wave is sinus. And here, you need to look that your P wave still is coming from the isoelectric line. As you see, T wave has completely formed, and here you have an isoelectric line, then the P wave has come after the completion of the T wave, and this is what we call it sinus tachycardia, and this is how we differentiate between atrial tachycardias and sinus tachycardia. In atrial tachycardias, the P wave does not come from the isoelectric line, okay? It fuses with the T wave or comes within the T wave, which means it makes a change in the size of the T wave. But here, no, the P wave came separately after the T wave, and it originates from the isoelectric line. That's why we call it sinus tachycardia. Sinus tachycardia is caused by sympathetic stimulus, which is either pain, hypovolemia, stress, or whatsoever. That's why you have to evaluate. If it is hypotension, hypovolemia, you have to correct the hypovolemia if there is hypotension. If it is a source of a pain or whatsoever, then the cause has to be corrected. Sinus arrhythmia, if you look at the rhythm is irregular. But each rhythm has a P wave before the QRS, and that P wave originates from the isoelectric line. It is a smooth, rounded P wave and has a normal PR interval. So if you split each complex alone, you have a sinus complex. But the only problem that you have, that this is an irregular rhythm. Usually, sinus arrhythmia, it's either respiratory sinus arrhythmia or non-respiratory sinus arrhythmia. Respiratory sinus arrhythmia happens when the patient takes a breath. The stimulation of the breathing stimulates the vagus tone, and the heart rate goes slow. When the patient exhales, his rate goes faster. So every time you have to look at respiratory complex and the ECG. So every time that you have a slowness or widening in the R2R interval, when the patient takes a breath, this is what we call it respiratory sinus arrhythmia. Usually, in these patients, this respiratory sinus arrhythmia does not cause a problem. But if sinus arrhythmia happens because the patient has digitalis toxicity, or he has acidosis, or electrolyte imbalance, okay, or he has any kind of myocardial problem, then and the rate goes low and it becomes symptomatic, then you treat it as bradycardia. Some patients, they might need permanent pacemakers. The SA block, and in the SA block, usually normal but vary because of the pause. What does pause mean? In one area where there is a complex has to happen, the impulse was originated in the SA node, but it did not leave it. That's why we call it sinus block, or we call it sinus exit block. If you look, the distance between the R to R here is exactly equal to two QRSs. So if you will cut this part and place it here, you will find that your R to R bit in the block is exactly equal to two QRSs. That's why we call it sino-exit block. The sinus arrest, as you see, there is a long pause in the SA node. In this case, the SA node has stopped working, okay, for a while. Any sinus arrest that is greater than 6 seconds will be considered asystole, because your patient will not have a heartbeat in this case. You have to start CPR for a patient. most patients with sinus arrest will end up to have a permanent pacemaker. And that ends the sinus rhythms. The atrial arrhythmias, we need to know that atrial arrhythmia, the stimulus for the P wave comes within the atria. So there is an area in the atria outside the SA node that created the impulse or stimulated the atria to contract. The premature atrial complex is a complex that happens within a sinus rhythm or any underlying rhythm, and the characteristics of that complex is an atrial P wave. If you look at this rhythm, you have a sinus P wave, and if you look here, after the T wave, there is nothing, okay? So that rhythm, okay, has a PAC. So this is how we diagnose a PAC, and the PAC repeated itself here. Now, why do you say this is a PAC? If you look at the size of the T wave in this complex and the size of the P wave here, you will see that there is only one wave between the two QRSs, and the size of that wave is bigger than the T wave and the P wave, which means atria has fired at the same time of the repolarization of ventricles, and that's why we call it a PAC. Usually, PAC is an ectopy caused by electrolyte imbalance, or the patient might have some myocardial changes, mainly ischemia or overstretch. Treatment is correct electrolytes, and if it has not been corrected by electrolytes, you might give antiarrhythmias. Non-conducted P waves, and as you see here, this is a P wave that has been fused with the T and is not followed by a QRS. There is a rhythm that looks like this one, which is the second degree AV block, okay, type 2, but in the second degree AV block type 2, the P wave is isolated down on the isoelectric line. It's not fused or interfered with the T wave. Any P wave that is positive and interfere with the T wave, we consider it an atrial P wave. So that's why we did not call this a second degree AV block. We call it atrial, okay, conduction, or premature atrial conduction that is not being conducted, or it's not followed by a QRS. The second level of arrhythmia is the paroxysmal supraventricular tachycardia. If it comes and go, and if it is permanent or persistent, we call it supraventricular tachycardia. Characteristics of supraventricular tachycardia, as you'll see here, you have a PQRST, and then you move to have only one complex in the middle of two narrow QRSs, and that complex, you cannot call it either a T wave or a P wave, because the amount of electricity here, the amount of electricity in this P wave is larger than the T wave, and larger than the normal P wave, and larger than the T wave, and that's why we call it supraventricular tachycardia, because you cannot identify it's either junctional, sinus, atrial. That's why it's called supraventricular tachycardia. Normally, supraventricular tachycardia is treated by vagal stimulus. You ask the patient to cough, or you give him adenosine, and if adenosine 6 followed by 12 did not function, then you need to cardiovert your patient. Atrial flutter, and in atrial flutter, the shape of the flutter wave is well known as the sawtooth, and the flutter can be regular and can be irregular, depend on number of flutter to the QRSs. In this rhythm, you will see that number of flutter waves to the QRS is fixed, so you see it regular. In some cases, it might not be regular. You might have three flutters, one QRS, two flutters, and one QRS in the same rhythm. Atrial flutter will always be treated if the heart rate is higher than 100. We call it atrial flutter with rapid ventricular response. You have to give beta blockers, calcium channel blockers, and antiarrhythmias. If the patient is unstable, you have to cardiovert, synchronize cardioversion. And in some of the guidelines, atrial flutter, it's treated like atrial fibrillation. You might start your patient on anticoagulation, because in atrial flutter and in atrial fibrillation, patient loses their atrial kick, and they will start to develop atrial clots. So anticoagulation has to start as soon as possible. Now, atrial fibrillation, the characteristics of atrial fibrillation is simple. You have a small, a narrow complex, and you have a T wave that you see it after, but in between, you have a fibrillating baseline. It is an irregular R to R with a fibrillating baseline. This is the atrial fibrillation. The treatment is like atrial flutter. If the rhythm is very fast, we call it rapid, then beta blockers, calcium channel blockers, amiodarone. If the patient is not responding to therapy, you have, or he is unstable hemodynamically, the treatment will be synchronized cardioversion. Okay? And you might see a patient with atrial flutter with third degree AV block as well, as what you see in this complex. R to R is regular, and you have no P waves in the middle, but the baseline is fibrillation. Junction arrhythms, the origin of the P wave in junction arrhythm is from the from the AV node. That's why the direction of electricity is inverted, or we call it a retrograde impulse, and that will cause a negative P wave. If you look at this rhythm, from here to here, it's regular, 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 then all of a sudden you have an early conduction. If you look at this early conduction, you have a T wave here, followed by an inverted P wave that causes an early conduction. Then it's back to sinus, 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 okay? So in this area, you have an early conduction, but the P wave is not up, the P wave is down. If you don't see the P wave, still junction, because junctional P wave can come within the QRS, or you might see the P wave after the QRS. So those are the characteristics of the junctional P waves. It might come before, during, or after. If it comes before, you see it inverted. If it comes within, you don't see it. If it comes after, you will see it after the S, and it will be inverted as well. PJC is treated like PAC and PVCs. The junctional rhythm, here you have a dominant junctional pacemaker, and this is what we call it a junctional escape rhythm, which means the pacemaker had escaped from the SA node down to the AV node. So SA node is not functioning, then AV node is taking the lead. Usually you see these rhythms with patients who have persistent sinoatrial arrest, okay? When you have an SA, sinoatrial arrest, then the patients will recover to a new rhythm, which is junctional. Look at it from R to R, it's regular. The rate is less than 60, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, it is 50. And the P wave is inverted. If you look at the P waves, all the P waves are inverted. So this is the characteristics of a junctional rhythm. Treatment as bradycardia, atropine, pacemaker, epinephrine, and dopamine. If the rate is still junctional, and why I say this is junctional, because the complex is narrow. All junctional, they have normal or narrow complexes, and you don't see the P wave. The P wave is hidden in the QRSs. Rate here is greater than 60, but less than 100, so we call it accelerated junctional rhythm, and we treat it like a bradycardia, if it is symptomatic. Now, in this rhythm, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Rate is 130. This is techie. So this is more than 100. Looking for regular, it is regular. P wave, I don't find a P wave here. But if you look at the complex, the S has formed completely. And then you have a wave after it. Then you cannot call it ST depression, because the S is completely and back to isoelectric line, because this is your ST segment. Okay? If you look here, this is your ST segment, and this is a P wave after it. That's why we call it junctional. Since it is junctional and the rate is more than 100, this is junctional tachycardia. Junctional tachycardia applies the same rules of atrial tachycardias, like AF, flutter, except for electrical therapy. There is no cardioversion for junctional tachycardia. Instead, if you give beta blockers, calcium channel blockers, amiodarone, patient did not respond, you have to use what we call it overriding pacer. So there is no cardioversion for junctional tachycardias. Instead, we need to use pacemaker. Now, the conduction is not well between AV, SA node and AV node. There is a delay. First degree AV block, usually we call it sinus rhythm with first degree AV block. Why sinus rhythm? Because R to R is regular, the rate is normal, I have a sinus P wave between each complex, this is sinus. But PR interval is longer than, if you calculate it from here to here, it's 5 complexes, okay? From here to here, 5 complexes. If you add these two, it becomes 7. 7 times 0.04 is 0.28, and now the interval is longer than 0.20, and that's why you call it first degree AV block. Treatment, if patient is stable, no treatment. If the rate goes down and the patient become hemodynamically unstable, then you might give him atropine, you might start him on epinephrine or dopamine infusion, or you might use transcutaneous pacer. Second degree AV block, we have two types. We have type 1, and type 1 AV block has one major characteristics, which is the prolongation in the PR interval. That's why we said in the beginning, it is important to look at the PR interval. If you look at the PR interval here, it is short. Here it's getting longer. Here it is getting longer, okay? If you look here after the T wave, you see a drop of a complex, which means there is a P wave that is not followed by a QRS. And if you look at this, it's a cyclic thing. PR interval is short, long, longer, and definitely if you continue the strip, you will see the complex, which is the P wave that is not conducted. So it is a cyclic phenomena composed of prolongation of PR interval until I end up with a P wave that does not have a QRS after it. And this is exactly the block. The block is having a sinus P wave that is not conducted. In the second degree AV block, you will see two configurations, a complete conducted complex and a P wave that is not conducted. So you see normal PQRST, normal PQRST, and then this one has no QRSs. So this is a second degree type 2. Second degree type 2 is more dangerous than second degree type 1 because this one is most likely to develop for a third degree block. Treatment for second degree and third degree, if they did not respond to atropine, definitely you will have a transcutaneous pacer, and then you need immediately to look for a permanent pacemaker. Now, this is to compare between second degree type 1 and second degree type 2. Second degree type 1 has a progressive prolongation with a drop in the complex, and the second degree type 2 has a permanent relation to PR interval, but there are non-conducted P waves, okay? For the third type of second degree is 2 to 1. Why do we call it 2 to 1? If you look at the complex, you have P wave, non-conducted, P wave, conducted. P wave, non-conducted, P wave that has been conducted. So each complex has 2 P waves. That's why we call it 2 to 1. The last AV block is the third degree AV block. The characteristics as the follows. R to R is regular, P to P is regular, but there is no relationship between P to QRS. So you see here, short, P wave here comes after the T. If you move here, P wave comes within the QRS. So when the P wave comes within the QRS, it means that there is a complete AV block. And you can apply the same concept here. R to R is regular, P to P is regular, but if look at the PR intervals, there are no relation. Here it's short, here is long, here the P waves comes within the T wave, okay? So this is a complete AV block. Most patients with a complete AV block, they don't respond to atropine. Then you have to have an option of transcutaneous pacer from the beginning, and then you have to look for implanted pacemaker or intravenous pacemaker. Finally, a comparison. First degree AV block, just a prolongation of the PR interval. Second degree type 1, progressive prolongation of PR interval until you have a block here. Second degree type 2, conducted P waves and non-conducted P waves. And the third degree AV block, you have R to R is regular, P to P is regular, but there is no relationship between to P and R. Atrial rate is faster than ventricular rate. The ventricular arrhythmias, which is now we are moving to the last part, PVCs, okay? The PVC is an abnormal conduction. The pacemaker is an abnormal point in the ventricle that fires within an underlying rhythm. In this case, you have a patient who has a normal ECG, a normal sinus rhythm, but all of a sudden he has a wide, bizarre shape, QRS. Always, T is opposite to the QRS, and you don't see a P wave. So this is the PVC, okay? treatment of PVC will always correct electrolytes and use antiarrhythmias. It might come as a multifocal when you have this shape and this shape, and it might come as couplet and triplet. Any ECG has a PVC more than three complex together, we call it it's a run of a PVC or it is non-sustained VTAC. Now, if the pacemaker completely escape to be a ventricular pacemaker from Purkinje's fibers, definitely you will see a ventricular complex, which is a wide complex that has no P wave and the T is opposite to the QRS. And here the patients definitely will be hemodynamic unstable, atropine, and pacemaker will be the treatment. If the rate has been faster than 40, which is 41 to 100, we call it accelerated idioventricular rhythm. Most of these patients, they need pacemakers. If the rate goes higher than 100 with the same characteristics, which is a wide complex, T is opposite to the QRS, here, this rhythm, if you see this rhythm in your monitor, definitely you have to shake a little bit to go and assess your patient because it might be pulse or pulseless. If it is with pulse, we call it a VTAC with pulse, it might be stable or unstable. If it is stable, it's okay. You can start your amiodarone 150 milligram over 10 to 20 minutes as an infusion. If it is unstable, you have to synchronize cardiovert your patient immediately. If you found your patient pulseless, this requires, according to the ACLS, requires to start CPR, defibrillate as soon as possible, and then you follow your ACLS guidelines, which says epinephrine every 3 to 5 minutes and amiodarone, two consecutive doses. One is 300 and followed by a 150 after that. If the patient has, if you look back, okay, this is a monomorphic VTAC. If you look here, you see a polymorphic VTAC. A polymorphic VTAC, we diagnose it as a polymorphic VTAC if the patient has a pulse. If it is pulseless, then it goes as ventricular fibrillation immediately. This can be related to QT or non-QT. Now, if it is a QT, we call it torsades de point. If it is non-QT, we call it polymorphic VTAC only. And the treatment here is you have to give your patient magnesium. If he did not respond to 1 to 2 grams of magnesium IV push, then the patient has to be defibrillated. For torsades de points of polymorphic VTAC, synchronized cardioversion is not recommended, then you have to defibrillate your patient. Ventricular fibrillation can be fine or coarse. Any patient with ventricular fibrillation, fine or coarse, this patient will be pulseless usually, okay? If you see a ventricular fibrillation, your alarm goes as a triple alarm, you have to run and check your patient pulse. If we find no pulse, definitely you have to start CPR and you have to defibrillate as soon as possible and you follow the same pulseless VTAC guidelines. Asystole, which is a flat line, never defibrillate an asystole, okay? It's not in the ACLS guidelines. Treatment is CPR and you can give epinephrine every 3 to 5 minutes, but the most important thing in asystole, you have to make sure that this is an asystole. We call it a flat line protocol. You have to check leads, you have to check, and you have to go from one lead to other lead on the ECG to make sure that this is asystole before you treat it. Okay, and that summarizes all our arrhythmias. If you have any questions, we'll open the camera and we have 5 to 10 minutes for discussion. Thank you very much. Thank you all. See you next lecture.